More than 100,000 years ago, when the land was not even aware of its own existence, the history of this unique area on Spain's eastern coast began. And so did the adventure of MARQ, the Provincial Archaeological Museum of Alicante. A place for immersing yourself in other times and for dreaming. For reliving adventures from the past that have marked the present and will affect the future. A history. A place on the Mediterranean. A door open to the world. MARQ is considered to be the best museum in Spain and one of Europe's reference points in the field of archaeology. This paradigmatic museum, along with the theme park Terra Mítica, is an excellent tourist destination that can be added to the already vast variety of cultural and leisure attractions that can be found along the Costa Blanca. MARQ shows the archaeological history of a generous land. A hospitable climate and an active people who have struggled to adapt and have left us an invaluable historical heritage. A treasure that this museum has investigated and which it now exhibits to the inhabitants of all five continents. Throughout your visit to this center, you will discover everything from the first stone shaped by humankind in the shelter of a cave to archaeological remains and the most decisive historical facts that gave this museum life at the dawning of the 20th century, when MARQ was born as an archaeological museum. And this entire heritage is reflected in its displays and permeates its walls through the most advanced and specialized technology available. MARQ is an initiative of the Provincial Council of Alicante, and through its determination and meticulousness, it is one of the most modern museums and one of the best prepared to face the future. Its mission? To show the past as seen from the present. But how do we know about these peoples from the Stone and Bronze Ages? And about their contacts with the Greeks and Phoenicians? How have the life, culture, and essence of the Contestanos, our Iberian ancestors, reached us? Why does Popilio, one of the main benefactors in the development of Lucentum, primitive Roman Alicante, enjoy an outstanding place in MARQ? How did Arabs and Christians coexist? Why were their cultures so deeply entwined? What is the origin of our community of Valencia? These peoples played a decisive role in a history plagued by reconquests, wars, and uprisings. And in its tour of the modern and contemporary ages, this museum employs surprising means to reflect urban development, the growth of industry, and the birth of modern-day society, the international Costa Blanca. MARQ is not merely a museum. It is a scientific complex that not only shows the public archaeological sites, but also reveals what happened and how. In these halls, we will learn about the techniques and methods that field, urban, and submarine archaeology use in the present in order to gain access to the past. Through the use of scenes, interactive points, and audio-visual displays, the hall devoted to field archaeology is presented as one large prehistoric landscape. A place where we can immerse ourselves in the mysteries of this fascinating science. One large scene reproduces a theoretical archaeological site. We are standing before a cave dwelling on two different levels. In the upper part, we can see a rocky wall on which its inhabitants drew samples of cave art. We can discover samples of Paleolithic paintings, macro-schematic art, schematic art, Levantine art, and Roman inscriptions. On the lower level, on different horizontal planes, we can witness how the excavation has gradually uncovered the different eras of human presence in the cave. Thanks to modern audio-visual technology, this scene shows the 14 stages of human occupation of this cave. On the surface, materials from the Middle Paleolithic, the Upper Paleolithic, the Early Neolithic, the Chalcolithic, and also from the Bronze Age have been recorded and documented. Above these, remains from the Iberian and Roman eras are exhibited. Finally, we can see evidence of human presence during medieval and modern times. In this way, thanks to a combination of real and fictitious images, visitors gain insight into both the basic principles of archaeology and the events that occurred in this space during the past 100,000 years. One of the most appealing features of this hall is the more than 15-meter screen with audio-visual effects explaining how the Alicante landscape has changed in the past 120,000 years. A hunter-gatherer observes the environment from his cave dwelling. He learns how to master his surroundings, how to transform the land to make it fertile, and how to domesticate animals. He will build huts near water and crops. And later, he will search for higher, more strategic locations. And he will even master stone and iron. He will exploit the land's resources. He will transform the land and master the environment. And he will invent the machine. The second hall shows us how archaeology works. MARQ has chosen the cloister of a 15th century church as the scene. Let us continue, immersed in the adventure of archaeology. In these surroundings, visitors will be surprised at what lies beneath their feet. This hypothetical urban site encloses within its walls columns and floor tiles. Life unfolding in this environment over the last 2,400 years. The excavations date the first settlement in this location from the 4th century BC. An Iberian construction built alongside a wall. A path with wagon tracks on the rocky ground. And the subsequent abandonment of the site in about the 3rd or 4th century BC, probably due to a fire. Over these remains, archaeological research documents a Roman household dating from around the 1st century AD. We can discover its mosaic, the cistern, the decorations, and nearby the cemetery, which yet again fell into oblivion for reasons unknown to us. MARQ's graphical resources reflect this process. In the 5th century, there were the remains of a necropolis, and later around the 12th century, a Muslim dwelling is located in the near vicinity. Of course, there were wars and reconquests. In the 15th century, the current Christian church was built, and this too reflects the passage of time and the human imprint. Whitewashing, renovations, graffiti, modern paintings, bricked up windows, the marks of stonemasons. In this hall, MARQ provides all of the elements needed to understand the archaeological evolution of a building. To do so, real images of excavations in cities have been used. Finally, the Archaeological Museum provides many screenings on the evolution of the main human settlements around the city of Alicante, from the Bronze Age up to the present day. Before visiting MARQ's large exhibitions, our tour of this scientific discipline's fieldwork finishes in the hall devoted to submarine archaeology, in one of the most international areas on Earth, the Mediterranean Sea, the Costa Blanca. Both terrestrial and submarine discoveries, and the documentation that has reached us throughout the ages, allows us to reconstruct the nautical and port activity of a large part of history. The importance of this section for the Archaeological Museum's work lies in the fact that the sea opened the eyes of the earliest Mediterranean civilizations to relations with other peoples, to commerce, and thus to birth and decline, to the development and the enrichment of our culture. Thanks to two excellent reconstructions, visitors can learn about a Roman boat that was moored on the wharf of a harbor, the placement of its cargo, the construction techniques of the age, the elements that made up the vessel. The other large presentation explains how archaeologists work, focusing on a vessel that sank in the 5th century. There lie amphorae and the corroded remains of Roman merchandise, surrounded by elements that make up subaquatic excavation techniques, such as grids and suction hoses. This static material comes to life thanks to the exhibition technology used by MARQ. Another major audiovisual display once again takes us on a journey through time. Our Neolithic ancestors' flimsy canoes navigate in pure, calm coastal waters. The first Iberian merchants, their sails and clothing in search of trade. The storms, causing shipwrecks and fragments of history that tell us what happened. The evolution of the vessels, of the Mediterranean coastal landscape, and the current harbour, a leisure centre and gateway to the sea. Now that we know how our heritage reached the Provincial Archaeological Museum of Alicante, and the methods used by archaeology and other sciences to interpret it for us, it is time to learn about the museum's five main permanent halls. Historical periods that have shaped our living environment. The Costa Blanca. Conveying all this knowledge is one of the keys to MARQ. This center stands out as a different kind of museum, both educational and enjoyable, unique in Spain and Europe. Far from being a typical museum, full of objects and explanations and little more, we discover a cultural and leisure space that is both understandable and simple, where we can learn about the different civilizations that left their mark on the lands of southeastern Spain. More than just a museum filled with objects and sites, this is a museum of cultural events, which bring to light the international influence on our cosmopolitan present. The Prehistory Hall covers a long period of time. It falls between the Middle Paleolithic, 100,000 years ago, and the Oriental period in the 8th century BC, when the Bronze Age inhabitants established their first contacts with the Phoenicians and Iberian culture was born. The main objective of MARQ's Prehistory Hall is to show us the way of life of our first inhabitants. The hunter-gatherers, the first farmers and shepherds, and the beginnings of metallurgy, the period known as the Bronze Age. Although we have few remains from our Paleolithic ancestors, we can imagine how the hunter-gatherers lived more than 20,000 years ago. One of the most meaningful finds from this period is the cranium of a woman who lived approximately 16,000 years ago in Cova Beneito in Muro del Coi. We should also mention the stone plaque with the image of a deer that was found in the shelter at Tossal de la Roca in La Valle de Alcalá. Another outstanding part of this section is the video about the technologies of these people. Solely through the use of images, we come to understand the degree of skill these humans reached in cutting flint or using files with bone handles. But the appearance of farmers and shepherds gradually imposed new ways of life. The changes that took place with the new visitors fit into the framework of the Neolithic period, approximately 8,000 years ago. At MARQ, we can find the new technologies brought by the farmers from this period. The boat-shaped mill for grinding wheat. Polished axes and adzes used to cut down trees and enhance crop sowing. Flint used for arrowheads. And the use of bone to make awls, spoons, or decorative objects such as rings, necklaces, or buttons. The first ceramic remains, used to store grain. Pieces that they decorated using cockle shells, which are known as cardial ceramics. The Archaeological Museum shows one of the most amazing finds in Alicante's prehistory during the Neolithic period, macro-schematic art, the best sample of which can be found at the site in Pla de Patracas. Praying human figures. The cult of the star. Harvests. Fertility. And geometric motifs. Using these elements, along with the archaeologists' interpretations and the impressive mural scene spanning the hall, we can enter into the life of the Neolithic age. Agriculture and livestock became the new way of life. Huts gave way to considerable settlements made of stone, located in strategic places in order to control the territory. But one of the most remarkable and innovative events is the use of metal. The Bronze Age began approximately 4,300 years ago. The sites from this period reveal daggers, molds, halberds, arrowheads made of copper and bronze, ivory and bone, ceramic and gold and silver were also manipulated. Decorations made of copper and bronze were created, exceptional samples of which remain. Yet change once again awaits this society. Along with the technological development comes an increase in relations with other peoples, mainly by sea. The last part in the prehistory hall is devoted to the Oriental period, or the First Iron Age. At the end of the Bronze Age, trade contacts multiplied, as can be seen by the slice of African elephant's tusk found at the site in La Mola de Agres. We are facing a period of considerable alterations and innovation. Contact with other cultures, mainly the Phoenicians, will bring about more changes, such as the use of iron and writing. Indeed, prehistory ends with the appearance of writing, and we thus enter the dawn of history. We will learn about the great Mediterranean civilizations. We will discover one of the most exceptional peoples who inhabited the Costa Blanca, the Iberians. With Iberian culture, Alicante, not yet aware of its own existence, enters history and begins to take on the essential characteristics of a land that is open to the world. The current day Costa Blanca. Between the 6th and 1st centuries BC, the lords of the Falcata, the Iberian sword, developed their culture in the Contestania, a territory in the southern part of the current community of Valencia. until they took on the impositions of the unstoppable, sweeping Roman culture. The Iberian Hall tells us all about these peoples through their writing, ceramics, and metallurgy. In this hall, MARQ brings to life information extracted from the numerous Iberian sites in the province of Alicante, the precise locations of which are shown area by area on an interactive panel. Although their economy was based on agriculture, fishing, and livestock, the Iberian tribes were highly developed traders, as can be seen by the Roman and Greek pieces found in their settlements. But they also created their own contestanean ceramics, rich in shapes and decorations. The original Oliva Liria narrative style, Elche Archena symbolic ceramics, and geometric decorations. Styles achieved thanks to the purity of the clays, the high quality obtained in their kilns, and the variety of shapes made, including amphorae, kitchen influence, and religious pieces such as votive offerings or incense burners. By interpreting the iconography found in friezes in their clay, and through the magic of images which breathe life into these scenes, we can recreate what their way of life might have been like. But without a doubt, the most important finds from this period are the Dama de Elche and the Dama de Cabezo Lucero, a female bust found in Guadamar, which dominates the Iberian Hall. Both sculptures, excellent examples of the statuary made by these tribes and their Greek influence, are closely related to the necropolis, sanctuaries, and funeral rites. This hidden and faraway world becomes meaningful in MARQ through the use of the technology used to decipher it. For instance, in this hall we find a fusion of reality and fiction in the amazing scene of an Iberian funeral rite. In addition, the Archaeological Museum describes cultural events that tell us about other vital aspects of these peoples, such as the layout of their towns and homes and the activities they performed there. Iberian economy was mainly based on agriculture, wine, oil, and fundamentally cereals. And linked to this activity was the development of metallurgy, as can be seen from pieces on the engraving of a pickaxe from the site in La Escuera, or the saw from Tossal de la Cala. They also kept livestock, and the sea was another major source of wealth. This can be seen through the presence of tackle gear such as fish hooks, special hooks for squid fishing called poteras, and fishing nets from La Illeta del Spagnets in El Campello, where we can also find the vestiges of wine production. This enclave served as the reception and redistribution center of merchandise from Greek and Roman traders. This trading was most likely led by the Iberian ruling class. Thanks to the remains that have been investigated, MARQ devotes a special section to Iberian hierarchical society. Men's and women's clothing and decorations. Instruments of war that define social rank, shields, greaves, lances, and the falcata. A purely Iberian weapon that was perhaps useless against the Roman advance. In addition to their mastery of iron, they were daring gold and silversmiths, and issued money that, along with stone, ceramics and lead plates, were used as the surfaces for the first written symbols in our history. Despite the ample evidence reflected on the coins and other surfaces, such as the exceptional engravings in lead from La Serreta in Alcoy, Conventaina and Penàguila, Iberian written documents have not yet been deciphered. We know the sound of their voices, but this voice faded out with the same force that the Romans exerted on the Contestanea. During the next three centuries, the Iberian world was inexorably absorbed. Towns abandoned. Resistance and repression. Extinction. Rome's unstoppable rampage. Throughout the next nine centuries, it will permeate a large part of the then-known world with its essence, its language, its architecture, its technologies, its culture. In the hall that the Provincial Archaeological Museum of Alicante devotes to the Romans, the period falling between the 3rd century BC and the 7th century AD is explored. The main sources of information on this culture come fundamentally from Luthentum, Ilithi, Dianium, and Aion. An analysis of these remains allows MARQ to give visitors a clear idea of what the periods of Romanization, the Roman Republic, the Roman Empire, and the fall of Rome were like. With the defeat of the Carthaginians and the gradual dissolution of the Iberian culture, the Roman Republic imposed its successful economic and social model in conquest after conquest. This period, called Romanization, took place during the last centuries before Christ. In this hall, we discover details of the conquerors from this period. Catapult projectiles. New offensive weapons of an invader, money, Roman ceramics and crockery. The Roman Republic would bring about great changes and would crystallize in the birth of the High Empire, the period of Pax Romana that would reign during the 1st and 2nd centuries and would involve our land becoming part of the Hispanic province of Tarraco. The known world would be shaped in the image and likeness of the Roman ideal. But one of the most important facets that has reached us from the Roman world is their lifestyle. Through an educational audio-visual display, MARQ transports us to a Roman city, a recreation based on Luthentum and La Idieta, two of the great treasures of our historical heritage. The city was one of the most fundamental elements in Roman territorial organization. We know about their architecture, their forums, their walls. And their homes, which were decorated with painted murals and mosaics. Not too far from the cities were the rural villages, places of agricultural production in which they processed raw materials, wheat, vines, and oil, for their subsequent distribution. One of the areas most positively affected by this period of Pax Romana and political unity was trade. Imported wine and oil, and Italian, Gallic, and African products. We know little about their exports, although their salting industry might have been one of the most important ones in this land. Without a doubt, all of these activities were translated into the powerful development of our coastal enclaves in Tarraco. And closely linked to this world of business is the Romans' invaluable numismatic legacy. Although in our province the only mint or coining workshop was Ilisi, current-day Elche, we can find asses and half-asses from the earliest period of Romanization. Denaria, aureus, sesterces and quadrants from the imperial period of Augustus. Silver coins from Diocletian. Solidus and silicas from Constantine. Pieces that reflect economic movements, devaluations, changes in power. But death, common to all cultures, was also present in Roman life. At MARQ we can find votive altars, figures made from a variety of materials related to the hereafter, and funeral monuments, which were more common in the High Empire, such as St. Joseph's Tower in Villa Joyosa. One of the burial sites recreated by the museum shows the funerary objects and decorations that accompanied the deceased. Although even more impressive is the inscription on one of these tombs, the one dedicated to Publio Astranio Venuzzo. I beg you, traveller, to say, may the earth be easy on you. But Christianity had already taken root in this Hispanic province. Throughout the early Roman Empire, around the 4th century, it experienced successive periods of persecution, tolerance, and permanent acceptance. And then freedom of worship was decreed in the Edict of Milan in the year 313, thanks to a proclamation by the Emperor Constantine. Roman ambition reaches its end. Throughout the 5th century, the Visigoths, allies of Rome, reached the peninsula with the aim of expelling the Suevis, Vandals, and Alans. The Roman model enters into a crisis. Once again, oblivion, abandonment, impoverishment. Jews, Muslims, and Christians fight each other and live side by side. But beyond the shadow of a doubt, they will bring major change to this Roman province during the next 8 centuries. The hall that the Provincial Archaeological Museum of Alicante devotes to the Middle Ages mainly shows us how our Arab and Christian ancestors coexisted during this time frame. This period is also key to understanding an important part of our cultural legacy, underlying numerous traditions and cultural aspects on which the towns of the Costa Blanca are founded. We begin this stage in the year 711, when the Berber and Arab tribes crossed the Straits of Gibraltar and broke Visigothic hegemony in Hispania. In a little less than 50 years, the new invaders' way of understanding the universe took root. We are witnessing a period of cultural coexistence that MARQ shows in a parallel, synchronic way on either side of this hall. Two religions, Christian and Islamic, condemned to understanding each other. The rupture with the Roman world is imminent. A new language and a new calendar are imposed. Different too will be the religion, agriculture and social hierarchies which put an end to Visigothic aristocracy with the unification of the entire territory under the Caliphate of Al-Andalus. The inevitable inclusion into the extensive Islamic Empire will once again open the doors of the as yet unformed Alicante to an almost unlimited world of trade. Good evidence of this are the bronze candelabra from the 6th century originating in Alexandria. The spherical perfume bottle from Iran, or the coins minted in mythical Bassora, which are exhibited in the display cabinets in this hall. This is the unique moment in time when the current towns of Alicante, Elche, Orihuela, Crevillente, Novelda, Elda, Villena, and Denia were established. Yet, inarguably, one of the greatest of our legacies from the Islamic world is that of the culture of water and irrigation, the appearance of crop fields, and with that, the ability to control food production, to generate up to 3 harvests per year. New plows, pruners, hoes, and horseshoes. Parallel to Islamic culture, the existence of another major way of understanding the universe is revealed. The feudal Christian way, subject to the rules of the Lord and servitude. Although they both lived side by side throughout the Middle Ages, we can identify a beginning and an ending for each of them in the 8th century. From this moment on, the Christian world would emerge as the survivor. MARQ highlights 2 fundamental aspects of feudal society: the Christian conquest of these lands by King Jaime I, and the genesis of an independent kingdom with its own statutes and laws, the Kingdom of Valencia. The Muslims, inhabitants of these plains and mountains for almost 6 centuries, were dispossessed of their lands, their assets, their religion and customs were persecuted. The museum takes visitors on an educational tour of El Cid's campaigns in the year 1090. They witness the transformations of the first Christian colonies in 1238, the founding of the Kingdom of Valencia in 1240, the year in which Jaime I provided the code of laws and statutes which are the basis of the modern-day community of Valencia. From this moment onwards, we find a new political structure. The recovery of Latin, the root of our language. The first currency minted in Alicante in 1296 by Jaime II. Just like the culture we see being extinguished, in the new society too, religion sets the patterns of daily life. Christianity marks the agricultural calendar. The church bells toll the dawning and the setting of daily life, work, birth, and death. MARQ provides us with the opportunity to learn about the sepulchral star from the necropolis in Denia, and the pieces found in the excavations of the Church of Santa Maria in Alicante, such as tools, carvings, the first ceramic siphon, or pitchers and vats from Catalonia, Granada, or Africa, which demonstrate the vitality of this metropolis since 1480, when it was given the title of city. This new recognition will bring with it the consolidation of the bourgeoisie, the development of port trade through the redistribution of products from America, and urban growth. The modern world arrives. Urban peace, the bourgeoisie, the town hall. The walls begin to come down. It is the decline of feudalism. The last permanent hall in MARQ is the one devoted to the modern and contemporary age. In this section, we will learn about decisive events in our more recent history, from the years 1500 to 1931, that perhaps have most deeply affected the culture that characterizes the lands along the Costa Blanca, its appeal, and its international scope. Through more than 300 artifacts and audiovisual documentaries, MARQ explains the social, cultural, economic, and political aspects of this period in two main parts. First comes the power of the crown, between 1500 and 1808, and the constitutional regime, from then until 1874. Secondly, the transition of the monarchic restoration to the proclamation of the Second Republic. The coat of arms of the old house of Alfoli de la Salle, dated from 1591, presides over the hall of the modern and contemporary ages. With this fascinating legacy, we are introduced to what the crown represented and its predominance over all other governing bodies. Of equal importance is the Bourbon coat of arms, which commemorates the construction of the Tibby Marsh Hermitage, the oldest in Europe, built between 1580 and 1594 by Philippe II in order to use the waters of the Monegre River to irrigate the crop fields in Alicante. From this period, we also have the Bernier Fortress, the island of Nueva Tabarca, residential architecture, churches, monuments, and the first vestiges of traditional industries. Engines of development in our main towns and cities. A considerable increase in port trade can be witnessed in this period, as well as the impetus brought about by the arrival of the railway. Evidence of this development are the plentiful pieces of glass and ceramics manufactured on the peninsula and all over the continent. These examples reveal the existence of a dynamic, refined society, as can be seen by the cups and saucers imported from the American colonies. The pharmacy jars, spittoons and other health-related artifacts, and also vests. Sewing machines and other elements related to fashion. Yet, in contrast to all these refined customs, in this hall we can see another of the more dramatic events that marked the period. The expulsion of the Spanish Moors in 1609. It is estimated that about 20,000 were forced to flee. This exodus led to a considerable decrease in Alicante's population, but there was a constant growth once again in the 18th and 19th centuries. The series of tiles on which these people's fantasies, ironies, entertainment and cooking elements are captured gives us an excellent insight into their lives. From this same period, we have illustrious personages from Alicante such as Jorge Juan, Manuel Martí and Sempere Guarinos, who travelled the world, investigated and broadened the culture of the time with their discoveries. Inkwells, writing desks, and hours of observation. In this hall, we also notice the liberal vicissitudes of this early modern stage, times in which the state played an important role in education. The artistic and literary Lyceum of Alicante flourished, and the main theatre, the Teatro Principal, was built. Despite these liberal leanings, the church, its institutions, and its shadow were ever present in daily life. The second section in the Hall of the Modern and Contemporary Age begins with the coronation of the Bourbon King Alfonso XII, the monarchic restoration of 1874. Agriculture, trade, industry and communication are sweeping through the province of Alicante at this time. It is the dawn of modernization and of the ascent of a social class linked to business and finance. Within this setting of the emerging bourgeoisie, we can also identify the rise of cultural trends such as modernism. A time in which the Archaeological Museum of Alicante was founded. With its opening on the 17th of January 1932 by the recently elected President of the Republic, Niceto Alcalá Zamora. Thus, the Provincial Archaeological Museum of Alicante is not only a center for exhibiting objects. We can discover a series of historical events, events that have been researched and interpreted. We are at a point of departure, a place that disseminates information to the people of the land in which the events took place. Luthentum. La Higueta, Pla de Petracus, a museum of living objects conceived to help us to understand the present and future from the standpoint of the past. Thank you.